If you're a woman looking for love, it might be wise to look very closely at this man's face. Grant Greentree is someone you never want to meet. He might seem like a smooth operator, attentive and full of affection, but don't be fooled, and whatever you do, don't be seduced by his boasts about wealth, especially the multi-million dollar properties he owns around the world with garages full of Ferraris. The reality is Greentree is one of the biggest cons we've ever encountered at 60 Minutes, a one-time bankrupt and fraudster who preys on vulnerable women. And his MO is simple. He steals their hearts to get to their money. This should have been a love story. The wedding of Grant Greentree and Kim Dale Quinn in the Yarra Valley in 2020.
I felt really proud. I was marrying, you know, my dream guy. He was everything I wanted. He was emotionally supportive. He was really loyal. He made me feel special. You know, it was fun. It was a celebration.
Love was in the air.
There was a lot of love in the air.
But the smiles here belie the truth. Kim didn't know it at the time, but she was actually Grant's third wife, with the previous two having applied for apprehended violence orders against him amid claims of physical and financial abuse. It was a pattern of behaviour he would allegedly repeat on his latest lover.
You said a few seconds ago that, you know, you were marrying your dream guy.
Yeah, I was. I was marrying my dream guy.
Was he? In the end?
In the end, he was everything but. He was the opposite. He was my nightmare.
In the wake of the Netflix series The Tinder Swindler, making international headlines...
$20,000, $30,000, $140,000.
Tonight, we expose Australia's answer to that notorious con man.
His tendencies are sociopathic.
$33,000.
Upwards of $200,000.
He too has repeatedly broken hearts and destroyed bank balances, although his preferred dating app is Bumble.
He texted me literally straight after the date to say, I'm coming off Bumble, I've met the woman of my dreams, I've found my soulmate.
And the more we investigated Grant Greentree, the worse it got.
I think I got off the phone and threw up. What the fuck have you done?
He's definitely a fraud. It's all about him and only him, and he does not care who he hurts getting to his goal.
But now, after decades of deceit, this man's deeds are exposed. Like so many Australians, Kim Dale Quinn had taken to online dating apps in the quest for her perfect partner. Her app of choice was Bumble. And that is where she matched with a man claiming to be 49 years old, going by the name McLean.
I've got his profile here. Mm. Can you read that for me?
Sure. Here we go. Charismatic yet reserved, confident yet humble, old world manners matched with cheeky wit, and I'm looking for caring and thoughtful, smart and beautiful, sexy and sassy, reveling in black tie together or pyjama days on a rainy Sunday at home.
You were looking for love.
I was. I was really looking for my soulmate. And I thought I found him when I met him.
A date was arranged and McLean spared no expense, suggesting wines and a meal at Melbourne's iconic Donovan's restaurant on the St Kilda foreshore.
And we just sort of hit it off straight away. Then he started telling me about how his ex-wife Elizabeth had had cancer and had passed away, and that had been his soulmate. So he was using all the words that would be emotive for me, you know, how loyal he was nursing her through her cancer. You know, he was crying as he was describing Elizabeth having morphine patches on her legs, the treatment, the last days, holding her hand, and, you know, he was in tears telling the story. And at some point, I think I was probably in tears too. It was a really emotive story.
Eventually, the mood lifted. McLean confided his real name was Grant, and he started revealing more about his apparent business prowess and his investment properties all over the world.
Oh, he talked a lot about what he had. It was literally like my house, my car, my yacht, my this, my that. You know, he was doing that. And I think you call it peacocking, where he was really coming on quite strong about what it was that he had and could offer a relationship.
So how many properties did he tell you he had?
Oh, look, I lost count. The Marais in Paris, Chelsea in England, definitely in New York. And he'd show me photographs of the one that he had in New York with Elizabeth, that he'd lived there. And he called it a bolt hole strategy, where he had properties all over the world.
What was your first impression after meeting, at this stage, McLean?
He was coming on really strong. I like a man who knows what he wants. I think, you know, he was love bombing. He was reeling me in very carefully.
The pair hit it off and got serious very quickly. Grant was seemingly a man of means and morals, and the rock Kim had been searching for. The couple enjoyed getaways together, days at the races, even up front at an Elton John concert. Grant was eager to impress and suggested he treat Kim to a holiday at Port Douglas's most expensive resort, Neuromyer. But when it came time to pay upon checkout, Grant all of a sudden said to Kim he needed her to foot the bill of close to $5,000.
Yeah, that was a bit of a punch in the guts. But he'd said he'd cover everything, and he said he would, you know, pay me back for that.
OK, so you're paying for it for now, but in the long run, he'll pay you back.
Yeah, he would. Yeah, he said so.
Did he ever pay you back for the stay at Neuromyer?
No, he didn't. And once he had my bank account details, and once my settlement came through and I sold my house from my divorce, that's when things really changed gears.
Grant was making his own property moves, though, telling Kim he wanted to buy them a family home. And not just any home, a waterfront mansion in the ritzy Melbourne suburb of Brighton.
What did you think the first time you saw this place?
Beautiful, but out of my league.
But it seems like Grant was very convinced that this was in his league.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. He wanted to know, you know, would his Ferraris fit, plastic car collection fit in the garage, and he wanted to go through every room in detail.
Throughout this period, Grant continued to get money from Kim for day-to-day expenses, as he looked at more than a dozen mansions on the Esplanade behind the area's iconic bathing boxes, even testing out the armchairs at some of the properties. He got to the point of signing contracts, only to continually pull out at the last minute.
Huge properties, 5 to 10, some are even more. I think one he looked at was closer to 18.
Million.
Million.
And so in your mind, here's this guy who owes you $5,000 for this, $20,000 for that. But you'd be thinking, well, if he can afford a house for $18 million, he's good for it. He'll pay me back.
Yeah, I did. And why would he be after my money if he's got so much? I didn't have my guard up at all.
By now, Grant had won Kim's heart, and the couple were enjoying life together. So Graham wanted Kim to meet his daughter, who we'll call Isabella. He said Isabella's mum was his now deceased former wife, Elizabeth. But this is where things really started getting weird.
He had told her that, like, my birth mum had passed away.
Just to be clear, is your mum alive?
Yes, yes, mum is alive.
Port Douglas in far north Queensland is paradise. And this is where Grant Greentree told his new love, Kim Dalquin, their future lay. The couple moved here in late 2021, and given he was apparently worth tens of millions of dollars, Grant was shopping around for a new Fontaine Peugeot yacht to cruise out to the Great Barrier Reef on.
What was Grant's demeanour on here? I mean, was the vibe sort of, yeah, this'll do me?
I think he was a little bit arrogant, to be honest. I mean, they'd gone out of their way to show us around and, you know, he was sort of like, oh, well, I want, you know, it's probably bigger.
So this wanted... boat wasn't good enough for him?
No.
Not only that, he was again scouring the property market for somewhere to call home.
The ones that we can see directly in front of us here, as well as
inspecting
around
the best mansions in town, including the eye-catching property known as The Edge, which won Australian House of the Year.
When you look at The Edge on the hill up there, I mean, it's the best property in town.
It's one of the best properties in Australia.
Grant suggesting he's going to buy that, it feels like a real statement, you know. I'm here, I'm in town, and I've got cash to burn.
Well, he's kind of like, if you're going to do it, go big. I think that was how he wanted to come across.
But it just didn't add up for Kim. While Grant was spruiking his fortune, at the same time, he kept hitting her up for comparatively small amounts. Not just loans, but also paying bills for accommodation and his membership at the Sydney Cricket Ground.
So after a few months in Port Douglas, are you starting to tally up just how much money he's racked up of yours?
My cost all up was getting closer to about 120, 130,000. He was like, put it on the tab, when I turn 60, you'll be good. And he used to say, it's going to go from famine to feast.
In your mind, were you starting to think, how are we paying for all this?
Well, he would cover that with, you know, his money that was coming in when he turned 60.
So he had a big superannuation payday coming, he told you?
He told me, yeah. And so he said, don't worry, I've got this under control, it's all good. Look, if you can carry us for a few more months, then when I turn 60, you know, I'll give you everything back. He wanted to, you know, return the trust and make sure that I wasn't out of pocket for, you know, his costs.
Kim was getting nervous, and her fears multiplied when she met Grant's daughter, who we'll call Isabella.
He genuinely cannot comprehend that his lies are lies. You know, I have a biological father, but I never had a dad, so.
It's a sad reality, but Grant Greentree's own daughter says her earliest memories of her dad are of a revolving door of women.
Well, they were pretty repetitive of just kind of like him having a couple girlfriends and then I wouldn't see them again and then we'd move to another random apartment in the city and a couple new girlfriends.
What are some of the words you would use to describe the way that he interacted with you?
It was like I was prioritised because I was like a prop for him and he had a very, I guess, set idea of who he wanted me to be and how he wanted me to look. And yet even, like, with some of his girlfriends, I remember, they would be, like, textbook Barbie, the blonde hair, blue eyes, like, all of that. And then whenever he would bring them over, he would say things like, oh, like, when you get older, you can look like her. Like, you can bleach your hair, you can get blue contacts. I was like, okay, like...
But even more vivid for Isabella are her dad's incessant lies.
There we go.
Typified by Grant telling her when she was younger that he'd bought her a horse.
And then as I've obviously gotten older, I was like, he didn't own that horse. Like, it stayed in a stable and that was like a business. There were multiple horses there. They owned all the horses. That was just the horse that I used for the lessons. And sometimes at lessons, I would use a different horse. So, again, I was still quite young, but I remember when they would sometimes give me a different horse, I'd be like, oh, what about my horse?
So when Grant decided to introduce Isabella to his newest partner, Kim, things didn't go as smoothly as he'd hoped.
We were planning to meet up at the shops, and he texted me and was like, can you get me and Kim a coffee? And I was like, I thought it was a typo for skim, like skim milk. I was like, a skim? I was like, Kim or skim? He was like, no, Kim, my wife. I was like, okay, so you're married and you've brought her and you haven't told me that you have a wife or that she's coming. That's fine. So yeah, obviously I assumed that he brought her along to impress her. The same situation.
Had he told you that Isabella's mum was dead?
Yes, she died 10 years earlier. And, you know, she died from cancer, quite painful cancer.
And so then Isabella mentioned, no, my mum's alive and well.
Yeah, she did.
She mentioned that she'd had a piercing recently and that her mum didn't like it, and she started just chatting about her mum, and I was like, wow, this doesn't sound like a dead widow.
Just to be clear, is your mum alive?
Yes, my mum is alive. And then you could see, like, the clockwork happening with Kim.
So she's got this moment of realisation that she's been fed all these lies. Meanwhile, what's your dad doing?
Oh, he turned the aircon of the car up to full blast and the radio to full blast so that she couldn't hear me.
If Graham was willing to lie to Kim about something like this, she was worried that everything he'd told her was made up as well. So to reassure his new wife, Grant drew up a chart trying to clarify which women he'd been in a relationship with and when, not to mention how many children he had along the way too. As Kim was soon to discover, what Grant thought would be the end of the matter was only the beginning.
Did you love him?
Yeah, I did. Very much. That's a bitter pill to swallow when you find out that everything that you thought was real wasn't.
Mel Sexton was on again, off again with her high school sweetheart, Grant Greentree, for more than 25 years. She thought he was in her past. But when we contacted her out of the blue, saying we were investigating his checkered history, she felt compelled to lift the lid on her former lover.
Sitting here now, having to think about some of the most unpleasant moments in my life is not easy. But I think necessary.
Why did you fall for Grant?
Oh, he was charming. Debonair even. You know, he always knew the right things to say, or he did, you know, opened the car door if you're going somewhere and treated you like a princess.
The lines Grant spun to Mel more than a decade ago were almost identical to those he fed his latest wife, Kim, all these years later.
He would come up here and even say, look, let's go and look at houses to buy. And we're not talking like run-of-the-mill houses. We're talking, you know, $2-3 million properties, like to the point where we actually physically go and look at them with the real estate people.
And who was going to pay for the house, him or you?
Well, he was apparently, but when I look back, I'd had a business that I had worked really hard at for 20 years and he knew I'd sold it. So I wonder now, was that him thinking, oh, she might have a bit of money in that?
At the time, though, Mel was smitten. That was until she started seeing unexplained charges appearing on her credit card, flights and hotels, and again, Grant's SCG membership.
The bank sums it up pretty concisely here. Fraud.
Yeah, fraud. $19,000.
So Mel just couldn't believe what she saw in her statement, so she called the bank to confirm.
How were you feeling in your stomach when the bank was reading out?
I was just like, absolutely, like, I think I got off the phone and threw up. I'm like, what the fuck have you done?
So how much did he owe you at that point, do you think?
Probably around $33,000.
And he assured you he was good for the money?
Yeah, absolutely, all the time.
What was his story?
The sign-on bonus. $30,000 sign-on bonus to the new company he was going to be working for.
And that bonus was due any time now?
Yeah, pretty much. It was always going to be, you know, at the end of the month. Never came.
At this point, Mel decided to go to the police. They followed up and Grant was charged with fraud.
And they just were there and arrested him and said that they want him to come to the station to be talked to. So then he went and got himself a barrister. And he fought it and he walked out of that courtroom free.
What was more damaging for you, the the financial side of things or the lying and the betrayal?
Money's just something that you use to live, you know, to pay your bills or... I was a very, very broken person for a very long time because I couldn't believe someone could be just so deceitful. And then when I started piecing things together and I got this phone call from a lady, so when she introduced herself on the telephone, it was like, oh, well, I wondered how long it would take you to call me. What do you want to know? So we had quite lengthy conversations and... she was quite scared of him at one point as well.
That lady who called Mel was another former business partner of Grant's, and it turns out the more you dig on Grant Greentree, the more his life unravels. His history of scorned partners, both business and romantic, dates back decades, and we've uncovered a history of court cases, fraud investigations, and accusations of violence against the women he supposedly loves. Grant's first wife, who's asked not to be named, took an apprehended violence order out against him in 2008. She alleged he cheated on her, assaulted her, and now has more than $400,000 of child support outstanding. Grant married his second wife in 2010, and within a year, she too had filed for an AVO. That second wife is the woman that Grant claimed he nursed through cancer until she died. We've spoken to her and confirmed she's indeed still alive. In a statement to Bondi Police in 2010, the second wife told detectives Grant Greentree had misused her father's credit card, and when she confronted him, he threatened her. Grant denied the allegations, but she said to police, "I'm scared he's going to do something to me. Scared for my life."
He called me and told me that he made the biggest mistake of his life and he can't stop thinking about me and would really love to see if we could make something work, either in Australia or here in the US. So he came.
The longer we worked on this story, the more women we discovered who'd seen the dark side of Grant Greentree. This is American Tricia Connors, who I spoke with over FaceTime.
Then next thing I know, I was pregnant myself. So that really changed things up. It was at that point that I really saw the negative side of him when I told him I was pregnant. He didn't want me to have the baby. He told me he would never support me. And that if I chose to go forward with having the baby, that I would live a life of misery and poverty.
Did Grant ever provide any financial support or child support during that?
A very, very small amount. He sent me a wire of $500 US for Joey for child support. And I mean, if I count that $500 three times, that wouldn't even cover a year's worth of diapers, you know.
Grant's third child, Joey, is now 23 and estranged from his father. Patricia finds some comfort in the fact that their life in Boston, half a world away from Grant, has helped keep them out of harm's way.
I know I dodged a bullet, and he's definitely a fraud. I would go as far to say his tendencies are sociopathic, and I really don't think he's capable of actually caring about the people he claims he cares about. It's all about him and only him, and he does not care who he hurts getting to his goal.
But Grant's brushes with the law aren't just limited to his love life. His work life is also littered with examples of burnt business partners taking action. In fact, he's a fraudster. Back in 2006, Grant Greentree was convicted of falsifying contracts as a salesman so he could claim unwarranted commissions from his employer. He was sentenced to a year in jail, wholly suspended. We also discovered that in the years after that, Grant Greentree was declared bankrupt after he failed to make payments on a BMW he had leased.
He was a guy with means, or at least he portrayed himself to be.
So we know all of this now, but back to Grant's third wife, Kim, and in 2021, she had absolutely no idea about her husband's horrible history. She was holding out for his 60th birthday, when apparently he was going to get a big superannuation windfall and finally hand back the hundreds of thousands of dollars he'd borrowed from her.
That is fantastic, thank you.
But when the day finally came, instead of a celebration, there was confrontation.
And I was telling him to stop, and I said, I'm going to the police. And I just got in the car and I drove, and I was terrified. I was terrified he was going to follow me. Terrified.
You know this place pretty well.
Yeah, I do. I do. This is the apartment that Grant brought me to.
So Grant owned this apartment, or...?
That's what he said. He said this was his apartment, that the small...
Like a number of women before her, Kim Dale Quinn was seduced by Grant Greentree. But his apartment in Melbourne sums up his deceit.
It's a bit beyond my league.
He told his third wife, Kim, he owned it. But after they tied the knot, she discovered this was one of his many lies. He actually rented it and was way behind on payments.
So this apartment that Grant supposedly owned to start with, and then in the end were renting, who ended up having to foot the bill for that?
Me, for all of it.
How much in total do you think?
Upwards of 50,000.
It took only a year of marriage for Kim to realise her husband was spinning her so many lies and bleeding her dry financially.
How out of pocket do you think you are in the end?
Upwards of 200,000. Probably more.
Was there a moment of realisation that you had been conned, or was it just this slow creep?
Slowly boiling the frog was an analogy he used about things. And I think that's what he did to me. Just slowly turn the heat up. Slowly, slowly, pressure cooking. I was his cash cow. He didn't want me to go.
Grant's line all along to Kim was that when he turned 60, he'd receive a very significant superannuation payout, and then everything would be fine.
That is fantastic, thank you.
But that milestone came and went, and still there was no money.
At this point, are you checking your bank account every day to see whether there's any money coming through?
Yeah, I knew there wouldn't be any, but I did it anyway. At that point, it was like lost. It was a write-off. I was never going to see that money. And I said, I'm not talking to you until I see that money in my account. It's over. You don't talk to me again. I'm leaving you. He got violent. He got angry. And the mask that had been, you know, caring, loving, soulmate fell away. And there was just this scared, angry little man.
And so what happened then?
He was like ripping my arm and my shoulder and almost dislocated it, and I was telling him to stop, and I said, I'm going to the police. And I just got in the car and I drove, and I was terrified. I was terrified he was going to follow me. Terrified.
What's the mindset of someone like Grant Greentree?
Oh, I think it's power. The elevated belief that you can convince someone in believing the story that you're putting up.
So it's not just about the money. There is that thrill of being the big man.
Exactly, yeah. A superiority, a complex of superiority, to think that you can sell anything, you can convince anybody, you can sell your story, and it's going to be accepted.
Frank Montiel is an expert in following money trails, having spent his career working as a financial intelligence officer in Australia and for the United Nations. He says fraudsters like Grant Greentree operate in a kind of grey area that doesn't really trigger any major criminal prosecutions.
A couple of $100,000 is a lot of money to a person, in the eyes of, I guess, white-collar crime investigators, it's not that big a deal, is it?
These days, most law enforcement and investigative entity of government do not have the resources nor the possibility of taking what they would call a small case. That is a problem. So most victims of that sort of fraud are advised to proceed civilly and they really never get anything back.
That is what's happened with Grant Greentree. While he has been convicted of forgery in his business endeavours, none of his former lovers has had any success chasing him for money. So while the notorious Tinder swindler's fleecing of numerous women eventually caught up with him,
but we needed to get payback.
Grant Greentree has now told confidants he has fled his troubles in Australia and is now in the United States.
Please call my US mobile.
Grant, it's Tom Steinfort here from 60 Minutes. I wanted to talk to you about some of your personal and financial dealings. If you could please call me back.
For Kimdale Quinn, she's coming to terms with the fact she'll likely never see her $200,000 ever again.
He plays on your trust, and that's the worst kind of crime.
Emotions make you do funny things and perhaps make you not question certain things. Hearing that as myself, I think there's red flags here.
Yeah, there was definitely a lot of red flags, and don't get me wrong, I absolutely questioned all of these quite deeply with him, and he had amazing answers, very creative. I mean, he's a professional. He came up with some really good answers that I went, okay, I had to question.
But for all the women we've spoken to tonight, their way of getting control back in their lives is the power of sharing their stories, hoping to stop Grant Greentree from ever wreaking havoc on an unsuspecting lover again.
There's a crime where you go in and you rob a bank, and you rob a bank of $200,000. You steal it. It's very different to slowly winning your trust and then taking it from you that way, through trust. It's a moral crime, and that's one that, you know, the law doesn't really look at. If it's a business situation, there are bodies you can go to, there are ways that you can try and claim something back or at least shut someone down. But in affairs of the heart, in anything that's about a confidence trick, there's no recourse for them. They can keep going. He'll keep doing this till he dies. If he can, he will.
You said to me, you're pretty confident that Grant would have a new girlfriend by now. What would you say to her?
Run. Run fast.
Hello, I'm Tom Steinfort. Thanks for watching 60 Minutes Australia. Subscribe to our channel now for brand new stories and exclusive clips every week. And don't miss out on our extra minutes segments and full episodes of 60 Minutes on 9now.com.au, as well as the 9now app.